All right, welcome back. So now we're going to talk about, since we understand the DFE methodology a little bit, let's talk about how do we put it into practice, into developing a process. Where does it fit into our product development process? It actually fits along the entire gambit. So if you look at it, you can integrate it into any standard product development process. You start putting out your goals, and the team that's going to identify and analyze this system, so you probably would need some kind of sustainability team. People have professional training in that. From the get-go, at the planning stage, it has to be an initiative that everybody has buy-in. If you don't have that, you're going to have competing forces. Some people are going to want to be going just cost, bottom of the barrel, and then you're going to have the people on the sustainability side say, no, this is the goals. No, those goals have to be aligned. Otherwise, you're going to have a really hard time with it. So you need to make sure that the leadership and everybody is on board with the process. Next up, it's under concept development, system level design. This is where you're deciding what materials you're going to use, what are the guidelines, what are your goals that you're trying to reach. And again, you don't have to try to do everything all at once. This can be a continuous, ongoing process. So when you get your first get-go of what you want to do, you can refine the design later, assess impacts. Even after your first initial products are out, you may improve even upon that. So don't think of it as you have to do everything up front. Of course, the better we get at this in industry, the more there will be lots of people that understand this process, and we can do it earlier and for every product instead of having to wait until after our product's out and then modify. So that's where the improve the DFE process even after production goes in. So if we look kind of a set of scale during the planning stage, we're going to set our agenda at that standpoint. At the concept development stage, this is where we're going to identify potential environmental impacts, make a list, probably make a list of priority, which ones are the most important for us to minimize, or if we can upcycle anything, make that a priority. Then select our materials and DFE guidelines. Then we get to system level design. This is where we're going to apply our guidelines to our initial designs. And that should be some of our benchmarking of how, when we look at our specifications, how are we doing on those factors. Detailed design, we're going to assess the environmental impact based upon what we've chosen. And this, again, gets down to our bill of materials. How much are we going to order? How many pounds of this metal are we going to use? Or how many tons of that type of plastic are we going to use? You know, whatever it is. Then we'll compare that to our goals. And then if we can refine and modify or make different choices, we can do so. And we can iterate that. We can iterate that until we get it to a point where we're comfortable with it. And then we reflect on our process and our results at this point once we have our product in production. So we can also look at the impacts of life cycles. So a materials intensive product impact is something like a computer. So here we've got, say, like an Apple or a Surface Pro, and it's basically the housing, the casing. And we've decided to use aluminum in this case versus some other material. And so we'll have relative impact. So from a materials impact, it's a really high impact on how that's going to affect the environment. However, the recovery might be great in this situation too. So how effectively we can recover those materials, again, keep it into the production life cycle, don't let it go into the bio life cycle, really affects what we can do there. However, the use of the product doesn't have a huge impact on the environment. Distribution may, production may. They may be fairly standard. And that completely depends upon how we do that as well. Versus we have a product where the use of the product actually has more of an impact. Then we may look at, okay, in the use of the product, if it's the way it's designed and the way it's used has a bigger environmental impact than the production of the product itself, maybe we need to reconsider either how it's used or modify the design so when it's being used, it has less of an impact. So in this case, if we have a combustion engine going to an electric engine, would have a far dramatic less effect on the environment because of use, because you're not emitting all the carbons. Carbon dioxide and some of the other components out of the exhaust pipe because now you've gone electric. Okay, So that's kind of a breakdown of the difference between a use-intensive product impact versus a materials-intensive product impact. So you may want to consider which category does your product fall under, so it gives you a little bit more focus as to what you want to do for improvements. So what are some of the guidelines? What are some of the best practices out there? Well, there's a lot. And again, there's a strengthening community that has been growing around these principles. So some example guidelines are: don't combine materials that are incompatible in recycling. That's a little bit tougher nut to decide until you have some people with some experience in these areas and with some professional training to know is something incompatible with something else. You want to label all component materials for recycling and on what type of recycling. So you already see that in plastics when you see the little triangle with the arrows in it with a number. The number designates what type of recycling it can undergo. And so we need to have the same thing for all of our materials. Enable easy disassembly into separate materials for recycling streams. This is important. If you make something that's really hard to disassemble, now it's that much harder to get the recovery process into play. Use no surface treatments. Now, that's an issue sometimes. So surface treatments could be coatings, paintings, all sorts of things like that. And the more you do that, the harder it is to remove those materials from the underlining material that you're coating. So that's something we gotta consider. Eliminate packaging, so minimize the packaging or have the packaging be recyclable itself. So you see tons of that. There's a whole huge industry in packaging now that it's exploded in recyclable packaging where everything's recyclable instead of used to be that only a fraction of it was recyclable. And also reduce the weight and size for shipping, because anytime you ship somewhere, there's a carbon footprint for that, particularly if you're shipping by truck or train or boat, you know, those types of things. But again, even shipping can do do things on their end to reduce that footprint as well if we start going to more electrics, which is what's looking like is on the horizon. For material guidelines, how do we choose materials? What are the best practices there? Use recycled and recyclable industry materials. So if you can already find a source where somebody has already recycled the material for you, you go from that source instead of a raw material that's straight out of the ground. Use natural materials, which then can be returned into biological decay cycles. So what's great about that is then when you're done and your product's done, you can send that stuff, grind it up, goes in, and now it's like plant food or maybe animal food in some scenarios. So those types of things are perfect for that type of category. Use processes which do not release toxic materials. So that goes without doubt, because we don't want to have toxins, period, because it hurts the biological cycle, which in fact hurts us. If you breathe, it's hurting you. Okay. Or you drink toxic water, that's not good for you either. Capture and reuse all hazardous materials. So if you... And there's a lot of chemical processes, granted, where you do make hazardous materials, but instead of just releasing it or dumping it, sequester it and either reuse it if you can, which you can in a lot of cases, or put it in a way where maybe you can recombine it with something else that is less hazardous or not hazardous. And sometimes you can come up with a new product or a new material or things like that. Okay, so here we look at an example. So if you looked at how the Herman Miller chair has changed over the last decade, now again, this is back to 2009, so it's almost 10 years ago. But if you looked at where they were in 1994, they completely had an unsustainable product. They had a lot of chrome bases here, a lot of different types of fabrics and materials. They weren't recycling anything. It was hard to disassemble, all sorts of things like that. And slowly over time, they got better and better at integrating all the way to where they got this C2 model, something that was very recyclable and easy to put back into play. So let's take a look at what they did. So this is their environmental goals. So they made some goals, not just for the product, but for the company. And their Perfect Vision 2020 is their target. What they want to achieve is zero landfill by their products. Okay, zero hazardous waste generation. So again, they're being very aggressive in this. Zero air emissions, or VOCs. zero process water use, and 100% green electrical energy use, and 100% of sales from their DFE products. So just right there, you're talking about some really lofty goals. Also, the company buildings were to be constructed with a minimum LEED silver certification, which is next to the kind of the gold or platinum certification that you can get for that. So they had some pretty big goals of what they wanted to do. So let's see what some of the processes that they did with their existing product lines on how they went about this. And we'll take the Herman Miller chair because that's an easy one to follow. What they really did is they redesigned everything for this C2 spine chair. So they still took some of the best technology of what they had, and then they refined all their design to do several things. So it's a multi-purpose chair. And if you notice here, they have it with a fixed base, but they all have roller base. It's environmentally friendly, has non-toxic materials. It has about 41% aluminum, 41% propylene, 18% steel by weight. So there are some areas where they still had to do steel for strength. Other areas where they could use it, they used aluminum. And of course, propylene. The recycled materials, they can recycle 44% by weight. 23% is post-consumer, so after somebody's already bought the chair, they can reclaim 23% of that. 21% post-industrial, so that's in the production. Less material content, it's 20 pounds lighter than most other task chairs. It was easy to disassemble, 86% easy separatable materials. And it goes without saying, when you see a lot of design, even design for manufacturing, easy to put together, easy to take apart. That's kind of the name of the game these days. Recyclable, 92% by weight. That's pretty high weight. And the production line uses 100% green power. So in other words, they're not using a coal plant. They're not using natural gas or anything like that. They're using renewables, 100% for their plant. And you're seeing a lot of companies doing that in a lot of different countries. No air or water emissions released in the production, because oftentimes you can get wastewater from a process. And they also have returnable and recyclable packaging. So the packaging itself is completely recyclable or returnable back to Herman Miller. Okay, so what was their assessment method? Well, they needed to look at where they were on material chemistry basis. Were they at a safe level? Were they low hazard level? Or do they not really know? Uncertain, which could mean medium or high hazard level. And they kind of figured out that, all right, they're about at a 33%, which puts them kind of in that lower hazard range, about a third of the way. Recycled content, 8.4%. And that's because they had post-consumer, and then eventually also wanted to get post-industrial. And limit the amount of virgin material that they needed. Disassembly, they were roughly about 33%, which again put them about a third of the way, where their separation time was about 30 seconds. So that's pretty fast if you think you could take that apart. And you use common tools, and they had everything labeled, so it was easy to disseminate. And where they scored on their recyclability was about a 25%. So on the low level is an upcycle. Again, that's where you, once you get rid of your product, you can put it right back into the environment and it actually helps the environment. Versus a downcycle is basically a reuse, recycle versus not feasible at all. So they were somewhere between the upcycle and downcycle. So, all right, some other examples. Nike has considered designs, and if you look at some of their newer shoes, they've actually implemented some of these. What they were looking at is the different materials they were using and analyzing that from a water intensity use, chemical hazards, amount of energy used, and the waste and recycling. So what they really proposed was new products that are going to be environmentally preferred materials. They wanted to have a materials analysis done to reflect the best practices. And so they're changing a lot of their own environmental values within the company. And their goal is for all new products to be developed using its considered design standards, which is what the materials analysis gives us. So they were going to extend it just to footwear by 2011. So if you look at all their footwear now, The designs are completely different than what they used to be before 2011. All through their clothing by 2015 and all their equipment by 2020. So they've gotten pretty far into this process. So it'd be great to kind of see what their materials analysis and their post-op, because we're basically almost there at this point. Samsung came up with a reclaimed mobile phone. So similar type of thing here. This was a mobile phone you could break apart. It's got biopolymer casing. It comes in recycled paper packaging, printed with soy-based ink, which is renewable. It's not a toxic ink. It has online instruction manual, so they're not printing an instruction manual with it. And it was ENERGY STAR rated for the charger. So overall, it was a much lower impact compared to regular cell phone. And this is actually an older style. They probably even have newer styles now. Ford with a smart gauge with eco gauge. Here they wanted the instrument cluster on the Ford Fusion and the Mercury Milong hybrids. They wanted to have engaging feedback for the drivers to figure out how the fuel system is working. If you notice, they even made some decorations to have some awareness. So here they're trying to give the user feedback on and modifying their behavior on that feedback. So if you notice, they get some EV measures on how much power are they charging up. And it almost becomes like a video game. It's similar to like the Prius I have. Once I started seeing I could check my gas mileage, I started figuring out ways that I could bump up that gas mileage as I'm driving, almost in a fun way to do it. So this was actually designed by Smart Design and IDEO, who I have a colleague that works for there, and Ford Motor Co. So this whole idea is you're not just improving the fuel economy by the design of the engine and those types of things and incorporating electronics, you're also driving better behavior and awareness of the consumer using the product. So this is one of those user-driven types of things. So by engaging the customer, so they get to make active choices while they're actually engaged in using your product, in this case, driving. There's also better packaging, which we've been talking about a lot. So Puma is really engaged in better packaging practices to where they have everything that comes in a single bag. They don't put the tissue in there anymore. They have a fully recyclable cardboard packaging, which breaks down really simply. And then the other part just becomes a bag that you can use post. And they're all made out of recyclable materials. So again, just different ideas on how different groups have gone through it. So some simple rules. So one, design products and processes with industrial materials that can be recycled continually. Again, that gets back to sustainability. If you can't do it continually, you're not quite getting there, because that means at some point you gotta stop. Well, with our population growth and how much more we have people consuming, we have to be doing better than that with no loss in performance. And that's a key too. We wanna have the performance and the function there. That way we can make new industrial materials. And so there's a whole world of research going on in making new materials. Next up, we have to design products and processes with natural materials that can be fully returned to the Earth's natural cycles, the biocycle, which is what we're talking about. This way, we can keep creating new natural materials and we wouldn't run out as long as we can produce faster than we use. Design products and processes that do not produce unnatural toxic materials. So if we don't make them in the first place, they're not going to be in the cycles in the environment anyway. That can't be safely processed. So if we can't process it and we can't keep it into the industrial cycle, we shouldn't take it out of the ground in the first place because we don't want to put it into the biocycle. And finally, we want to design products and processes that have clean, renewable sources of energy rather than using fossil fuels. There is no good argument to keep using the fossil fuels on that regard. There was just a report out today in the Wall Street Journal that our politics have gotten in the way of that process to where they want to subsidize the coal plants to keep them from shutting down. But they're highly inefficient compared to the other options. Natural gas is far cheaper and has much lower environmental impact. Yet we're trying to subsidize these things. nuclear. You can make an argument a couple different ways based on that, but you still have the nuclear waste that you have to deal with for 10,000 years. That's still an issue. But we have the price of solar is coming down, wind is on again, off again, with the on-ramping of a lot of ways to store energy, because you can't always make it continuously, but if you could store it, now you have a buffer, so you can have a constant production system. Also, if you can generalize and put the production across a wide variety of areas instead of centralizing production, now you've got something that's very similar to the internet. So if you put production of energy in renewables in lots of different places, now you just have to have a smarter network. But in doing that, it makes it much harder for any of that network to go down. So you can look at it from a security standpoint. If you really want to push ahead and make those arguments like, well, we need energy security, great. Generate everywhere. Nobody can shut down your grid if you're generating all over the place and you have storage distributed throughout that system. You just got to have a smart switching system so that when something happens, you can shut down areas and work on it safely for workers and those types of things. So the solutions are there. We just actually have to have the will to be able to do it. Okay, so final message on green design. One, don't let old thinking get in the way of future solutions. You're not going to solve these problems with old ways of thinking. That's kind of the other way to put it, right? Is it easy? No, it's hard. It's hard, wicked problems, and that's what we need this generation for. We can solve these things and we can do it, but we need your help. Is it important? Absolutely, it's important. It's the survival of my kids, your kids, our grandkids' kids, and all the other life that's on this planet, because that's all we've got. And it's our responsibility. There's nobody to hand it off to. There's no, we'll let another generation take care of it. We don't have time for that anymore. But also remember, you can be really scared and want to stick your head in the sand, but this is a huge opportunity. There are massive industries that are just fledgling industries now that can be made out of this because of the opportunities that are there. So there can be a lot of money to be made in doing it the right way. So I like to leave off with a positive point on that. So thank you very much for joining me today, and I hope you enjoyed the class, and I hope you enjoyed this lecture. Thank you.